Let's take our Bibles then, turn to Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21. I'm following an old lectionary of readings that were used at the time of the Reformation in some of the Reformed churches, but which we can trace back at least to St. Jerome and earlier. We think Jerome was building an earlier material for readings that follow the Christian year, and we're using the readings for the Advent season. And last week we looked at the story of Jesus entering Jerusalem at the beginning of the last week of his life, and in many ways, in a prophetic action, he demonstrates why he came into the world the first time, and he demonstrates what he's come into the world to do. That is, he's come to be the king, and he has come to save. We heard the people with their hosannas, which means, "Lord, save us, Lord, save us," as he enters the city. We saw him coming into the city, being received by the people. And then we saw him going into the temple and cleansing the temple. He came to be a priest, and he came to deal with the house of God and to clean up the house of God in order to perfect the worship of God, so that today we worship God in Jesus Christ, who is the final temple. And we approach God and we have communion with God in Jesus Christ, who is the final temple. And when he comes again, he's going to begin in the house of God, separating the sheep from the goats. He's going to separate the nations, and he's going to take the power and reign. And it's that second coming that we're going to read about today as we read from Luke chapter 21. Let me read from verse 20. "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its destruction has come near. Then those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let those who are inside the city depart. And let not those who are out in the country enter it. For these are the days of vengeance, to fulfill all that is written. Alas for women who are pregnant, and for those who are nursing infants in those days. For there will be great distress upon the earth and wrath against this people. They will fall by the edge of the sword and be led captive among all the nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And there will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth distress of nations in perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." And he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they come out in leaf, you see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all has taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away." What we are reading here is an excerpt from a larger teaching block, often described as the Olivet Discourse. It's an extended block of teaching during the last week of our Lord's life, and you can find fuller accounts of it in Matthew 24 and references to it in Mark 13. The teaching was given on the Mount of Olives across the Kedron Valley from Jerusalem. If you imagine the Mount of Olives here, Jerusalem here, the brook Kedron in the middle. Jesus is on the Mount of Olives. He has just been in the city and gone down the hill and up the mountain on the other side. In many ways, this is the climax of his prophetic ministry. He has prophesied that he would be taken and that he would be killed and then that he would rise again from the dead in the very clearest of terms, three times prophesied. And those prophecies will be fulfilled in detail within just a few days. If it's the middle of the week, then just within 3 or 4 days, those prophecies would be utterly fulfilled. But in this chapter, in the middle of the week, he's looking further ahead, and he does something which we find many of the prophets of Israel doing. Many of the prophets of Israel will give you, in their prophetic ministry, near to hand, and then in the middle distance of time, and then in the far distance, prophecies regarding things that are going to happen within 10 years, or within a generation, 40 years, or perhaps in a couple of hundred years, and then things that were going to happen 800 years in the future, or 2,000 or 3,000 years in the future. And the reason for doing that is that those prophecies that are very explicit, that were going to happen near at hand, establish the prophetic ministry of the individual, Jeremiah, Isaiah, whatever. So you listen to them. And then as what they said will happen in the middle distance of time, perhaps 20 years later or 200 years later, that happens according to the Word of God. That's how they get their prophecies in the Bible. And then on the basis of those prophecies coming true, we believe that the future prophecies will come true. You can see this happening in Isaiah all the time. Isaiah gives a prophecy about a virgin will conceive and bring forth a child. It's a kind of judgment prophecy on the king Ahaz at that time because he didn't believe the word of God. So Isaiah gives him this promise it's not going to happen within his lifetime, but then he follows it up with something that's going to happen within 10 years to Syria, the very people that the king is afraid of. And then he prophesies what's going to happen in a couple of hundred years, the exile into Babylon, and then what's going to happen in 800 years' time, the birth of Jesus. And then he prophesies things that are going to happen at the end of history. And so they're building up, layer upon layer, they're building up a picture of God's purposes for the world. Jesus does the same here. He talks about things that are going to happen in the near future, within a generation, within 40 years. And then he talks about things that are going to happen in the distant future. Distant to him, and we don't know how distant to us because they're in the future as far as we're concerned. He has two subjects: the end of the temple and the end of the world. The end of the temple and the end of the world. Verses 5 through 24 focus on the end of the temple. Verses 25 to the end focus on the end of the world. Jesus has just left the temple. We saw him going there with the disciples. We saw him taking a whip and cleansing the temple. We saw him making a great claim that the temple was his house, the house of the Lord. And as they're leaving the temple, some of those who are with him begin to comment on the majesty of that building. Some were speaking of the temple, how it is adorned with noble stones and offerings. It was an impressive place. If you've ever been to St. Peter's in Rome, for example, it is the most impressive building. It often reminds me, as I think of St. Peter's, of how the temple must have impacted the people who went there. The sheer space within that building has a sense of greatness. It makes you feel small and insignificant as you feel you're in the presence of God, which is what it's intended to do. And the temple must have impacted these people, and they start to comment on this to Jesus. And he replies back in verse 6, "As for these things that you see," that is the temple, "the days will come when there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." The temple would be utterly obliterated. Do you know that they have not found anything of the temple in Jerusalem, even where they think it was situated, is not entirely clear as far as the scholars are concerned. Many think it's the Dome of the Rock is built on top of it. We don't know that. The wall that's there is part of the old way in which the city and perhaps the temple area was kept from sliding down the hill, but it's not part of the temple wall or the temple itself. Jesus' words were entirely fulfilled. Now, what we need to do is remind ourselves as we come to this that the death and resurrection of Jesus marked the positive achievement of his life as he came to bring salvation. For by his death, he removed the curse from men and women, and by his resurrection, he delivers eternal life to men and women. So he deals with the thing that keeps us away from God and reconciles us to God by his death, and he demonstrates by his resurrection that the promise of God, that we will live the life of God in eternity, is a good promise demonstrated by his resurrection from the dead. And not only does his resurrection point us to eternal life, it also points us to the enabling power of the Holy Spirit to all his believing people. The negative effect of Jesus' death and resurrection is associated with the destruction of the temple. Verses 12 to 19 foretell a period of time between Christ's death and resurrection in which the nation, that is the nation of Israel, the Jews, would be provided with decisive evidence of the truth of the gospel. We think of the resurrection, we think of the empty tomb, but there's also a description in these verses of the supernatural endurance of the believers when they're persecuted, when they're delivered up to the synagogues and prisons, and when they're brought before kings and governors for Jesus' name's sake. This is going to be their opportunity to bear witness, and bear witness they will. They don't need to come up with something to say, because at the moment that they stand before these authorities, Jesus promises them, "I will give you a mouth and wisdom which none of your adversaries will be able to withstand or contradict." He will provide them with the words. That's a promise to these early Christians, to the apostles and others who were brought before the kings and the governors. It's not necessarily a promise to you that you don't have to do any preparation to speak. All of our lives we're spent preparing what we will say if we're ever hauled before the authorities and have to give a testimony about Jesus. But there was this remarkable, supernatural provision of what was going to be said for these early Christians. And the reason for this period of time between the resurrection of Jesus and the destruction of the temple is that Israel had 40 years, 40 years to know about the resurrected Lord Jesus, 40 years to observe in the apostles demonstrable evidence that they had the same powers as Jesus had to heal the sick, to expel demons, to raise the dead. 40 years in which God is reaching out to his people. 40 years in which hundreds of thousands of Jews came to a knowledge of Christ and followed Christ. But the promise that Jesus now makes is that will all come to an end. It will come to an end when the city and the temple are destroyed, as they would in fact be destroyed. Jesus gives a pointer to the signs that his people will know what's going to happen. He says to them in verse 20, 21, Jerusalem will be surrounded by armies. There's your first clue that you're in trouble. The day of retribution to fulfill all that was written will come to be. This will be a sign to the people of God, to the Christians, to evacuate the city and the countryside as the end of the beginning is sealed. Now, these are Jesus' words. Jesus' words that echo the prophecy of Daniel in Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, when he talks about two things. He talks about the Messiah being killed, and he talks about the city and the temple being destroyed. Listen to Daniel. The Messiah will be cut off and will have nothing. The people of the ruler who will come, that is the fourth kingdom, the Roman kingdom, will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end, and desolations have been decreed. Jesus is echoing the language of Daniel that the city and the temple will be destroyed. The way that they dealt with Messiah would have implications. And in verse 24 of our chapter, Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. The destruction and desolation would be done not by Christian nations, but by pagan nations, the Romans. And it would not be done because of anti-Semitism, because there's no place in the Bible for anti-Semitism. Just as there's no place in the church for anti-Semitism. Because the Bible says, Jesus says, salvation is of the Jews. If we are Christians today as Gentiles, it is because of the Jews who gave us God and who gave us God's Son and who gave us the message of salvation. We are Christians when we go to one Jew and in him we find God and we find the salvation of God. It's in this context then of specific fulfilled prophecy within the lifetime of his hearers that Jesus then begins to speak about the end of the world. And as he talks about the end of the world, he has some advice for us. Here it is: be watchful, be hopeful, and be faithful. First of all, be watchful. Our Lord does not want the coming events that point to the end of the world to take us by surprise. Now, there's a sense in which, if you read this chapter over, you'll find, you would be blind not to find, that the events of AD 70, the fall of Jerusalem, and the events of the end of the world, which hasn't happened yet, are kind of compressed together as if one would follow the other directly. Now, why is that? Well, the reason it is that here is Jesus speaking from heaven. He's speaking as the prophet of God. He's speaking as the Son of God. In heaven, there is no linear time. In heaven, there is no time. In heaven, it is eternity. In eternity, there is no passage of time. In eternity, everything is God's today, God's now. In eternity, where Jesus currently is, everything has already happened. In eternity, the events that we see playing out in time as creatures are already fulfilled. That's the reality. And therefore, the kingdom of God exists, the new age exists in the eternal today of God's existence. In heaven, there is what someone calls the forever presence of Jesus, and the forever presence of Jesus throughout the whole of linear history is always at hand. It isn't that Jesus has gone on a journey and he's doing something until whatever time in the future, and then suddenly he comes back. The language of Jesus' second coming is not that language. It's the language of someone being here and suddenly appearing. You go to someone's house. You don't know there's someone standing behind the tree. You're having your party. They're there all the time. You don't see them as you're having your party, but they're behind the tree. And then suddenly they step out, and there they are. The language of Jesus' second coming is that he is always present. He is always there, and that when you see him, when he steps out, as it were, behind the curtain of glory and appears a second time, it is not that suddenly someone who was not present is now present, simply that you see his presence. One scholar has put it like this: all the historical signs of his imminent return are always present. The future is always present because the risen Jesus, who exists beyond time, is ever present in time. He exists, if you like, not in time at all, but he's always present. In the risen Jesus, the present and the future are one because he embodies them both. Now, there are signs in this chapter. There are signs that will be observed throughout this age, to one degree or another, in terms of their intensity. Jesus talks about them in this chapter. He talks about false teachers. In verse 8, he says, many will come saying, I am. That is, I'm God, or I'm the supreme being, or I'm the top dog, or I'm the great leader, or whatever language they use. In some ways, Hitler personifies someone who got it into his head that he was, as the supreme leader, the one who captured and who framed and embodied what the German Empire was to be. He is the great savior of Germany and of the world. And there have been figures like Hitler, figures like Muhammad, the prophets who come. False prophets would come in my name, Jesus says. Some would say the time is at hand. There are people like the Jehovah's Witnesses who, in the early part of the 20th century, were saying Jesus is coming back on such and such a date. And when the date came and nobody saw anything, they said, I bet he did come back, you just didn't see him. It's your problem, not his. So Jesus says false teaching is going to be a characteristic of the period. This period in which we live. Not only that, he says in verse 10, nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes in various places and famines and pestilences. Not only that, he says, verse 13, there'll be periods of persecution, which will be an opportunity to bear witness. That's verse 13. He says this, you'll be delivered up even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and some of you will be put to death. Jesus says, these are the signs of the times. These are the signs that God is at hand, that God is on the move. These signs are there throughout this period in which we live as reminders of what is coming in the future. The book of Revelation has the ascended Lord Jesus going into heaven, and first thing he does when he's in heaven, just risen from the dead, is that he gets the book. And in the book are written all the events of human history as they unfold. Who gets to open the book and let those things happen? Jesus does. He opens the book and there's wars. He opens the book and there's famines and pestilences. He opens the book and there's gospel preaching to the ends of the earth. He opens the book because Jesus is in charge of history. But then Revelation takes you further up, if you like. It lets you see the same landscape again, and it says these things that are happening are not only indicators that Jesus is on the throne. These are the trumpet blasts. The trumpet blast as God warns the world, these things, the wars, the famines, the pestilences, the earthquakes, these things, the upheavals in society and in industry and commerce, these are meant to alert the world. There's an end coming. And then Revelation takes you higher up still. It lets you see the same landscape. And it says, these very things that are signs of Jesus' reign, these things which are used by God as a trumpet blast. If you won't listen to my word, you'll listen when there's a war or a famine or an earthquake. These things are also signs of the final judgment when the bowls of wrath are poured out upon the world. And these are the things that happen during the time of the Gentiles. These are the times in which we live. This is our time. The times of the Gentiles would be marked by centuries, even millennia of opportunities to receive the gospel. So far, we've had 2,000 years to hear the gospel. During the period of the Gentiles, the gospel will be preached to all the nations. But here's the thing. Don't get up on your Gentile horse and think you're better than the Jews. Because the Gentiles will be no better than the Jews. They will prove to be just as hardened to the gospel. And the times of the Gentiles will come to an end. That's what Jesus says here in this passage. They will come to an end. Our time will end too, just as decisively as the time for the Jews ended with the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple. And actually, one of the things we read in the Bible is that when the time of the Gentiles comes to an end, there's going to be a great ingathering of Jews into the kingdom. And then the end will come. When the end draws near, the world will be thrown into absolute crisis. The end, as Jesus described it, will spell the end of the world system as we know it. It will be the end of the global industrial complex. It will be the end for the money markets. It will be the end in Revelation, the great picture of society as we know it, the world culture as we know it, is described as the great prostitute Babylon. And when the end of Babylon comes, when mighty Babylon falls, when the structured, organized kingdom of Antichrist, we call the world system, finally comes to an end. The great men of the world, the politicians, those who run the great conglomerations of the world, the people of influence, the people of power, all the peoples of the world that benefit from the social and industrial and commercial life of the world, that is everybody, is going to be in terror as the sheer fabric of civilization comes to pieces. And not only that, but the powers of the heavens shall be shaken, Jesus says in verse 26. Matthew tells us more. He says, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven. He's describing the end of the world as we know it, the end of the universe as we know it. This is the teaching of Christ. This is the teaching of the church for the last 2,000 years until N.T. Wright came along. N.T. Wright's view is that this is just apocalyptic language that describes the fall of Jerusalem as God's judgment on Israel. Wright's problem is that he doesn't pay enough attention to the text, nor does he listen to 2,000 years of Catholic Christian interpretation, nor does he pay attention to how Jesus' language is interpreted by the apostles who were there. Romans chapter 8, creation, that is the created order, has been subjected to futility. Creation waits eagerly to be set free from its bondage to corruption. This created order, the universe, is in a state of decomposition. That's a fundamental biblical idea. It's in the second law of thermodynamics. The entropy of the universe is rising. That is, its decomposition, if you will, is increasing. Or listen to these words by Peter. Waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Are these words from the writer to the Hebrews? He speaks of the removal of things that are shaken. That is, things that have been made. What he's saying is this: everything that is outside of God is subject to being shaken, to being moved, to being rattled, to being dissolved. Everything outside of God. And there's coming a day when that will happen. When everything that can be shaken, that is, everything that's been made, will be shaken, in order that that which cannot be shaken may remain. We have no idea what this looks like. There are going to be dissolution in everything. There are going to be signs in the stars and the cosmos. There's going to be loud noises that are not of this earth, as it were. Things that in space and around us that are going to strike terror into the hearts of men and women. The end of the world. Jesus says, be watchful. Jesus says, be hopeful. Be hopeful. The world is full of angst, isn't it? The world is wondering whether it's going to end as a nuclear midnight or climate catastrophe or cosmic collision. We come up with our own ideas. We don't have to wonder. And sometimes Christians find themselves caught up in the latest zeitgeist. As Jesus describes the approaching end of the world, he describes the state of mind of the world. This is what it's going to be like. There will be signs in the sun and moon and stars and on the earth, distress of nations in perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and foreboding of what is coming on the world. Near the end, as the Bible describes it, the earth will be drenched with the blood of the martyrs. There will be a savage, fierce persecution. There will be terrible changes in the visible sky with terrifying sounds. And it will be important that we remember this sermon if we're alive when that happens. The believer lives in hope, not fear. Why? Because that day heralds our redemption. Look at verse 28. When these things begin to take place, that is, all the signs and tribulations, look up, raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Redemption is something you get when someone has paid a ransom price for you and you're liberated. Jesus says he had come into the world to give his life as a ransom for many. If you're a believer today, you have redemption. At least you have part one of redemption. I get very irritated when NCIS runs its story over two episodes and you've got to wait a whole week. A whole week for part two. I mean, that just shows you the level of my IQ, but I don't mind. I don't mind. Well, here we are. We have part one of redemption, the redemption of our spirit, so that if we die today, we go to glory, we go to heaven, we go to be with Christ, which is by far the best. Part two is the resurrection of the body. Part two is the recreation of the universe. The universe can't wait for that, Paul tells us in Romans 8. The universe is on tippy-toes, waiting for the day we get our resurrection bodies so that it gets to be recreated by the power of God. The redemption. We're waiting for the kingdom of God that exists in heaven, that is reigning the world over the world just now. The events of the world that we think are accidents and punishments or whatever are indicators that the world is not under our control. It's under His control. All our best plans fall apart. Why is that? It's because the world is not governing itself. That's why we have all these things that shake the great men of the world who come up with their great ideas, and very many often have the best of motivations, and yet things get out of their control. You elect a leader who gets into some office somewhere with great promises of what he wants to do. And he means that he wants to do it. But he finds in office that there are forces, there are powers at work that he cannot control, no matter how many votes he got into office. The world is out of our control. And there are these constant reminders that we're going to answer. The world is going to answer one day when Christ comes. The winter of our discontent. John Steinbeck, by the way, was quoting William Shakespeare when he stole the title for that book. The winter of our discontent, that is this present experience of the trials and tribulations of life, are not so much the signs of winter as the signs of spring. They're reminders to the believer that the day of God is coming. We're waiting for the kingdom. And we're waiting for the Lord himself. Look at verse 27. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. It's taken from Daniel chapter 7. The language of the Son of Man is taken from Daniel chapter 7. And Greg Beale, who teaches at Westminster, he tells us that in the old Greek, that this Son of Adam, this Son of Man, comes as the Ancient of Days. There in Daniel 7, you have a picture of God on the throne with long white hair, and he's called the Ancient of Days. And the old Greek says that when the Son of Man approaches the throne, he comes as the Ancient of Days. Well, I think Dr. Beale's right, because he very often is. And I noticed, although he probably knows it too and said it, I just haven't read it, that in Revelation chapter 1, when it's describing the Son of Man, when John turns and he sees one like the Son of Man is described as the Ancient of Days, the hairs of whose head were white like white wool. He will come as the God-man. He will come personally, publicly. Every eye will see him. You see, there will be this great transformation of everybody, believer and unbeliever, enabling them to see what they cannot see now in their creaturely manner. And at one instant, everyone who has ever existed, everyone everywhere who has ever existed will in that same instant see Jesus Christ come. That will either spell fear to those who don't know him or joy to those who do. Be hopeful. Your redemption, your kingdom, your Lord are coming. And be faithful in the meantime. In the meantime, what are we to do? We're to rest on his word. Heaven and earth will pass away. That's an absolute certainty. Heaven and earth will pass away. We sing at Christmas, heaven and earth will pass away when he comes to reign. That's absolutely right. There will be an end to this order of things. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Trust that. Look back to Jerusalem. What he said happened. You can trust his word. What he says about the future will happen too. And then look for his coming. Rest in his word. Look for his coming. Let it be something that you anticipate. Not in a morose way. I remember the first time I went into a movie theater. We were good Christian boys, and we were not allowed to go to movie theaters. But I remember I had an afternoon off school, and I snuck into a movie theater. And I have never been so glad in all my life to come outside the movie theater to see the sun shining, cars going, driving on the roads, and to go home and find my mother and father still there. Because they'd said, you know, my mother's thing was, would you want the Lord to find you in a movie theater? Look for his coming, but don't be paranoid. And then persevere in his service. Persevere in his service. Don't be weighed down by things. He says here, by your endurance you will gain your lives. Actually, there's a lovely little thing there in verse 18. There's a lot of hard things coming that you will face in your life. There are even more terrible things coming that people at the end will face in their lives. But here's Jesus' promise, not a hair of your head will perish. That doesn't mean you won't take ill or you won't die, but you won't perish. You will not perish. By your endurance, you will gain your lives. The day of God is coming. It's a salutary thought, isn't it? But just as surely as Jesus in his first coming came in obscurity, so he will come again in great glory. Not in that poor, lowly manger with the oxen standing by. We shall see him. But in heaven, set at God's right hand on high. Lord Jesus, our heart cry is, come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Take the power and reign. Hasten the day when the kingdom of this world becomes the kingdom of our God and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. Amen.